This is the Unit 1 and 2 review from your Algebra 2 first semester final review assignment. So in the first set of problems, we're looking at solving our absolute value equations. We're going to graph the solutions on the number line. So in the first one, we have x plus 1 in the absolute value is equal to 6. In order to solve, we're going to take it outside of the absolute value. We're going to say x plus 1 equals 6, and x plus 1 equals negative 6. That's because if it's an absolute value, we could have a positive or negative value inside that absolute value that gets us to 6. So solving on the left equation, I get x equals 5. The equation on the right, I get negative 7. If I quickly check and plug those in, if I plugged in 5, I would get 5 plus 1 is 6. Absolute value of 6 is 6. Plugged in negative 7. Negative 7 plus 1 is negative 6. The absolute value of negative 6 is positive 6. So those are both of my solutions. I'm going to place them on the number line. So I have a point at negative 7, positive 5. Number 2, we're looking for the absolute value equal to negative 7. Now we're not going to be able to get an absolute value that equals negative 7, or equals any negative, so this one is actually no solutions, because an absolute value is always positive, and we can't get it to be equal to negative 7. Just in case, though, let's check and solve it as we would if we didn't notice that, and see if it would problem would come up. 5 minus x equals negative 7, and 5 minus x equals positive 7. Now again, this is wrong. It's not working. We already know it's no solution. But if we kept solving, we would get negative x equals negative 12, so x equals 12, and negative x equals 2, so x equals negative 2. And this is a good reason why we check our answers, because maybe you forgot in the beginning. You didn't notice that the absolute value is equal to a negative. This allows us now to go through and check to make sure our answer fits. Well, 5 minus 12, the absolute value of it is positive 7. Positive 7 is not equal to negative 7, so that's why that doesn't work. 5 minus negative 2 is positive 7, and that is not equal to negative 7, and that's why no solution is our answer. Number 3, what we need to do is get the absolute value isolated. So we subtract 1 from each side. We have a 12 on the right side, then we divide that by 4. And we get the absolute value of x minus 3 equals 3. So that becomes x minus 3 equals positive 3. X minus 3 equals negative 3. So I get x is 6, and x is 0. Now I check my answers. If I plug 6 in, 6 minus 3 is 3. Absolute value of that is still 3. 4 times 3 is 12, plus 1 is 13. If I go with 0, 0 minus 3 is negative 3. The absolute value of that is positive 3, times 4 is 12, plus 1 is 13. So both of those answers work. We're at 0 and 6 on the number line, so it'll be those points. Number 4. I'm going to say 5 minus 2x equals 13, and 5 minus 2x equals negative 13. I get negative 2x equals 8. Divided by negative 2, I get negative 4. Then we have negative 2x equals negative 18. Divided by negative 2, I get x is 9. We check our answers. If I plug in negative 4, I get 5 plus 8. The absolute value of that is 13, so that works. If I check with 9, I get 5 minus 18, which is negative 13. But again, the absolute value of that is positive, and it is positive 13. So we have our answers are negative 4 and 9. Number 5. I'm going to subtract 6 from both sides, and I get 2 equals 2 times 4x plus 3 in the absolute value. Divide by 2, and I get 1 equals the absolute value of 4x plus 3. So now I'm going to say 1 equals 4x plus 3, and negative 1 equals 4x plus 3. So I get negative 2 equals 4x, So x is negative 1/2 for the first one. Negative 4 equals 4x, so x is negative 1 for the second one. Now we check our answer. So if I plug negative 1/2, if I plug negative 1/2 in, yeah, we'll fill this one in, why not? Good one to check. So I get 8 equals 6 plus 2 times the absolute value of 4 times negative 1/2 plus 3. So 4 times negative 1/2 is negative 2. Negative 2 plus 3 is 1. So it really comes out to be six plus two times the absolute value of one. And we can see the absolute value of one is one, times two is two, plus six is eight, so that's gonna work. Look at the second one. Eight equals six plus two times four times negative one plus three, and then the absolute value. Let's clean up that absolute value. I have negative four plus three is negative one. Absolute value of negative 1 is positive 1, times 2 is 2, plus 6 is 8, so that's true. So our answer will be negative 1 and negative 1/2 on the number line. It's those points. Last one. So I have 20 minus 4x equals 2. And 20, we'll do it up here, 20 minus 4x equals negative 2. So I get negative 4x equals negative 18. So that gives us x is 18 over 4, which is 9 over 2. If we check that answer real fast, 20 minus 18 over 4 times 4, it's really 20 minus 18. Which is 2, so that's going to work. We could look down at our negative. We have negative 4x equals negative 22. X equals 22 over 4, which is 11 over 2. Plug that in, I get 20 minus 22 over 4 times 4. It really becomes 20 minus 22. Absolute value of that is positive 2, so it works. Our answers are 9 over 2. And 11 over 2, we'd also know those as 4.5 and 5.5, and you could put those on the number line. I would, but, well, I ran out of space. All right, on to the next screen. Now we're looking at absolute values with inequalities. And the same idea where we take the positive and the negative, we're going to continue that. But now, if we look at number 7, I'm going to move the absolute value over and take the opposite sign. So where it was less than or equal to 6, I'm going to make it greater than or equal to negative 6. So, now I can solve the two. So it's really two separate ones, if you'd like to do it that way. I'll do left side first. I'm going to add 2 to both sides, negative 4, less than or equal to 4x. So x is less, or I guess I could, negative 1 is less than or equal to x. Other side, I get 4x is less than or equal to 8, so x is less than or equal to 2, and now I need to graph, and this is where we have to be a little more attention because it's an inequality. We still have the critical values of negative 1 and 2. Now, it's a less than or equal to, so we know it includes those points, but now we have to look at the shading. So we know x is bigger than negative 1, so that suggests it's going to go in this direction. We know x is less than 2 from the other one, so it actually looks like they're in between, and it's any value in between. We'll change colors. Negative 1 and 2. So that would be our graph of the solution. So that means, which is different than just the regular absolute values, that 0 could work, 1 could work, any value between negative 1 and 2, including those, would work as the solution, and the graph needs to reflect that. It kind of looks like a barbell if you look at it. These graphs will not go in the same direction. If it didn't work that it was between them, it would be in the opposite direction, and it would be heading in the opposite directions, which we'll likely see some of those as well. Okay, let's go to number 8. I'm going to move over my absolute value, or my inequalities, put it on the other side, change the sign. So I get negative 1 is greater than or equal to 8 minus x over 3. And 8 minus x over 3 is greater than or equal to 1. Subtract 8 from both sides on my left equation. I get negative 9 is greater than or equal to negative x over 3. I'm going to multiply both sides by 3 now, and I get negative 27 is greater than or equal to negative x. Now I have to make it a positive x, and for this, whenever I multiply or divide by negative 1 or a negative, when I'm solving with these, I'm going to flip the inequality. So I'm going to multiply both sides by negative 1, so it now becomes 27 is less than or equal to x. Let's get our other value, we'll look at graphing them. I'm going to subtract 8 from both sides again. Not 8, x over 3. So that would be, subtract 8, it would be negative 7. Multiply both sides by 3, I get negative 21. Same thing applies with the negative. Now x is less than or equal to 21. We have to graph it. We'll draw a number line. Our critical values are 21 and 27. Now if we look, we said that 27 is less than or equal to x, or x is bigger than 27, and x is less than 21 is what our two values have. So that means it includes those points, and it includes the values less than 21, which is what our second equation found, and the values bigger than 27, which is what our first equation found. So that would be our graph of the solution. So this means any value smaller than 21, bigger than 27 would work. Anything in between those would not work. So those arrows go in opposite directions. You're going to find they either go in the same direction or opposite direction. Or they go towards each other, I should say, or in the opposite away from each other. They're not going to both go to the left or both go to the right. All right, number 9. Let's first get the absolute value isolated. So I'm going to subtract 1 from both sides. That gives me negative 8 over here. Now, you may be thinking, well, how am I going to do an absolute value when I have a negative? But we have that negative out in front of the absolute value. So that's actually going to flip and make it absolute value of x plus 9 is greater than positive 8. So this the same thing applies with the inequality we looked at on the previous problem. If I multiply or divide by negative, it's going to flip the inequality and, of course, changes the sign. So now I'm saying the absolute value of x plus 9 is greater than 8. So let's move over, put that negative 8 is greater than x plus 9. So I get my two equations. The first one, I get x negative 17, so that says x is less than negative 17. The second one, x plus 9 is greater than 8, I get x is greater than negative 1. So when I draw my number line, I have negative 17, negative 1. Now, I say an x is less than negative 17, so it goes in that direction, in the negative direction from negative 17. And I have that x is greater than negative 1, so it goes in that direction from negative 1. Now, I don't have less than or equal to or greater than or equal to, so this means I leave it open, draw an open circle, because that doesn't include the points negative 17 and negative 1. So our graph is not going to be bubbled in there. Those points aren't included. It goes all the way up to it, but doesn't hit negative 17 or negative 1. Okay, now we look down at number 10. We'll move over our inequality, make that negative 8. So negative 8 is less than 4x plus 12. We get negative, we should write our other equation before we forget. 4x plus 12 is less than 8. So we get negative 12 subtracted from both sides over on our first equation. We get negative 20 is less than 4x. X is greater than negative 5, or negative 5 is less than x. Back to our second equation, I get 4x is less than negative 4. X is less than negative 1. Let's go and graph it. Our two critical values. Notice here that we're not equal to. It's just strictly less than or greater than. So x x is bigger than negative 5. Bigger than negative 5. So that means I'm going to go in the positive direction from negative 5. And x is less than negative 1. So I'm going to go in the negative direction there. So it looks like I'm going to shade between the two points. But it doesn't include them. So leave it open. Draw a little circle there. That would be my graph of my solution. Number 11, we're looking at an absolute value being less than a negative. Now, an absolute value will always be positive. If it's always positive, it'll never be less than a negative. So this one, we can tell right from the beginning, is no solution. And that's because an absolute value will not be less than a negative. All right, on to number 12. Number 12. Here we have an absolute value is greater than or equal to a negative. Now this is actually very similar to number 11, but it's a very different answer. Here we're saying an absolute value is going to be bigger than a negative. Whenever I plug in for x, it's always going to come out positive because it is an absolute value. I could pick the biggest, or I should say the smallest negative number I can think of, negative a million. And if I plug that in, the absolute value makes it positive. So this one will actually work for any number. So we're actually going to say all real solutions. And that's because an absolute value is always greater than a negative. All right, on to number 13. We need to determine if our point is in the solution. Now, if a point is in the solution, that means if I plugged it in, it would confirm in both equations and means it would work. So again, this is x, this is y. So if I plug it into my first equation, we'll look at number 1 first, I get 2 times negative 2 plus 0 equals negative 4. That's negative 4 plus 0 equals negative 4. Negative 4 equals negative 4. That one's good. Second equation, 3 times negative 2 plus 2 times 0 equals negative 5. I get negative 6 plus 0 equals negative 5. Negative 6 and negative 5 are not equal, so that one doesn't work, so it's not in the solution. Not a solution, we should say. Not a solution of the system. Okay, on to our next screen. Now we're looking at graphing our systems of inequalities. So for number 14, we're going to use this graph up in the top left. The first one I have to graph is x is less than 2. This is going to be a vertical line for x. We're going to draw it along the x is 2. And it's going to be a dashed line. That's because it's just a less than. If it was less than or equal to, in that case, it would be a solid line. So it's got to be a dashed line here. And that's a good thing to check before you start graphing it, because it's a lot easier to go back and fill in a dashed line. But if you make a solid line, it's rather difficult to make it a dashed line without erasing the whole thing. So that's our first equation. Our next equation, we're going to change into slope-intercept form. So by subtracting 3x from both sides, I get negative 3x plus 3. So that means I'm going to go up to 3, and my slope is going to be down 3 over 1. And so we can draw our dashed line as best we can here. A little easier on a piece of paper. Okay, there's our dashed line. Now we need to find the solution. Now a good way to check is just to pick 0, 0. As long as the equations don't go through 0, 0, you can plug it in, and it'll typically tell you which side to shade on each of them. So x is less than 2. If I plugged in 0 into there, I'd have 0 is less than 2. So that means I'm going to shade on the left side of my first equation. I have y is greater than negative 3. 3x plus 3. If I plugged in 0, 0 into that, I get 0 is greater than 3. Now that is not true, so that's false. So I'm not going to shade on 0, 0 for equation 2, but I'm going to shade on the right side of it. So what it becomes is our solution will be this wedge almost of the graph. So anywhere on those points, it meets both equations. Okay, number 15. I have x is greater than or equal to 3. So now I can use the solid line. There's my first equation. And if it's greater than 3, it's going to be on the positive side of it. And my other equation, or inequality I'm going to graph, I should say, is y is less than or equal to 4, so that's going to be a horizontal line. And less than or equal to 4 means I'm going to shade below, right side of 1, below 2, so my solution will be that bottom right corner. And again, this one's a solid line because it's the less than or equal to, or greater than or equal to. It has the equal to it. Okay, 16. Let me get the easier ones out of the way first. X is greater than or equal to negative 1, vertical line through there. Now, greater than or equal to, shade on the positive. Y is less than or equal to 3, through there. Less than or equal to means I'm going to shade below. So right now I'm looking in the bottom right of that area. Now I've got to find line 1. Line 1 is negative 3, is my y-intercept, and it's down 2, or up 2, over 1. So let's see, I start from here. Negative 3, that would help, negative 3. Start from negative 3, and I'm going to go up 1 over 1. About right there. We'll go in the opposite direction. So, we're going to shade to the right of 1, below 2. On line 3, it's a greater than or equal to. So, if I plugged in 0, 0 into that to test that point, so it's either going to be on the top or bottom of 3. If I plugged in 0, 0, the top side of it, I'd get 0 greater than or equal to negative 3. That is true, so this point is true in all of them, so I'm going to shade in this triangle on the inside, and that is my solution. Okay, last one, 17. We're going to do a little bit of work on 17 first. I'm going to change them both to slope-intercept before I graph them. So for the first one, if I subtract 2x from both sides, I get y is greater than or equal to 2x plus 5. Second one, let's see, we're going to get negative 2y is greater than or equal to negative x plus 6 by subtracting x from both sides. Now since I have a negative 2, I'm going to divide both sides by negative 2. Flip the inequality because it's a negative. So I get x over 2. Minus 3. So now when I go to graph, I have 2x plus 5, so I go up 5. My slope is up 2 over 2. About there. That's my first one. Second one. Negative 3, my slope is 1 half. So I'm going to go up 1 over 2. About right there. And about right there. So that's 2. And we better extend our bottom line here. All right. So now we're going to test. I could test 0, 0 on both of them. That would probably be a nice way to start. If I test 0, 0 for equation 1, I get 0 is greater than or equal to 5. So that's false. So I'm going to shade on the top side of 1. If I test that for 2, I get 0 is less than or equal to negative 3. That's false, so I'm going to shade below that. So actually, the point they have in common, or the region they have in common, is down here, because this is on the top side of 1 and the bottom side of 2. All right, on to our next screen. 18, solve the following systems algebraically. So I look at the first one, and what I see here is I have a variable already isolated. Y is by itself. So here I'm going to use substitution. So if I substitute equation 1 into equation 2, it's going to let me solve. So 5x minus 9 minus x, so instead of y, I just write what it's equal to. I get 5x minus 9 plus x equals 3. Becomes 6x minus 9 equals 3. 6x equals 12. So x equals 2. Then once I have that, I substitute that back into equation 1, which was again y equals 9 minus x. Y equals 9 minus 2. So y equals 7. So my solution is 2, 7. We could check those real fast. 7 equals 9 minus 2. That's good. 5 times 2 is 10. Minus 7 is 3. So that one's good too. So they both work. Our solution is 2 and 7. 19. So I don't see any variables with without any coefficients. So substitution's probably out. This one, our best bet will be elimination. So I'm going to find a variable to eliminate. You usually want to find the easiest option. Y looks like my best bet, because if I can get y eliminated, one of them is positive and negative, I can solve for x. So I'm going to do, let's see, if they're both 10, they would add to 0. So I'm going to do 2 times equation 1, which is 16x plus 10y equals negative 26, and 5 times equation 2, which is 15x minus 10y equals negative 5. Now I combine them. I get 31x plus 0y, which was my goal, equals negative 31. And x comes out to be negative 1. Now I'm going to substitute that back in. It honestly doesn't matter which one we substitute in. I'm just going to substitute in the second one. So it's 3 times negative 1 minus 2y equals negative 1. Negative 3 minus 2y equals negative 1. Going to add 3 to both sides. Negative 2y equals 2. And y is negative 1. So my solution is negative 1, negative 1. We check real fast. 8 times negative 1 is negative 8. Same thing with 5, I get negative 5. Those add to negative 13. And then 3 times negative 1 is negative 3. 2 times negative 1 is positive 2. So I get negative 3 plus 2 comes out to be negative 1. So that one works. All right, last one, 20. I'm looking at this one. I'm seeing equation 1 I can get by itself. So I'm going to use substitution. All right, again, substitution. So let's see. If I add y to both sides, I get that equation 1 is actually x equals y plus 8. So now I'm going to substitute that into 2 and say 3 times y plus 8 minus 3y equals 12. So that's 3y plus 24 minus 3y equals 12. 24 equals 12. Wait a minute, what happened to the y's? Well, 3y minus 3y is 0. So I get 24 is equal to 12. That's not true. So that means there's no solution, because we came up with a false statement. Now, if I came out and that 24 was equal to 24, that just means I have infinitely many solutions. But in this case, since it gives me a false statement, it's no solution. This one doesn't work. If we think of these as a graph, these two lines would actually be parallel, so they would never intersect and we would never have a solution. Okay, 21. We're solving some word problems here. The key thing with word problems is we need to write two equations. Once we figure out the types of equations, we typically can solve pretty easily. So we have 27 binders sold for $56.50. This tells me I have two variables. I have large binders and I have small binders. So we're just going to call X will be the large, and Y will be the small. Now we need to write our two equations for it. The fact that I have 27 binders means I'm going to have an equation with an actual count to it. So that's where X plus Y equals 27. Then I'm going to have an equation with money that uses it. So the cost for a large binder is $2.50, so 250 times X, or just 2.5 times X, plus 1.95 Y equals 56.50. Now those are our two equations we're going to use. One little thing I would do just to make things easier is I'm going to multiply my second equation by 100, or really move over each decimal two places, because that now gives me 250x plus 195y equals 5,650. Now you may be thinking, why'd you make the numbers bigger? What I really did was got rid of the decimals. So maybe that'll make things easier as I go through and solve. So how I'm going to solve this one is I notice that X plus Y equals 27. If I take the first equation, I can write it as X equals 27 minus Y, which means I'm likely going to do a substitution. So now I can substitute that into equation 2 and say 50 times 27 minus Y plus 195Y equals 5,650. So now we're going to distribute. We can multiply it out, solve for y. 50 times 27 is 1,350 minus 50y plus 195y equals 5,650. When we get 1,350 minus 145y equals 5,650. We subtract, it should be a positive 145, let's try that again. If we subtract 1350 from 5650, we get 145y equals 4300. And that divided by 145 comes out to be 4,300. Wait a minute, we have an error here. There's a problem. This is not dividing equally, because if we divide 4,300 by 145, we get 29.65 approximately. And that's a problem because we should be looking at whole binders. So if you've seen the error, that's good. You're ahead of where I'm at. What I did is I didn't copy in my equation correctly. It should be 250 times 27 minus y. So we actually have to go back and fix some of these. So we're going to take out that part and that part. So now we need 250 times 27, which is 6,750, and 250 times y, that should be negative 250, so now we get negative 250y. That is going to be combined with negative or positive 195y, which means we have negative 55y. Bring down the 6,750. Okay, now we subtract 6,750 from both sides. 5,650 minus 6,750, we get negative 1,100. That's not 145 anymore. That's negative 55. So 1,100 divided by 55 turns out to be 20, so y is 20. But if y is 20 and we need to know that x plus y is 27, we could plug that in and x is 27 minus y. 27 minus 20, we get x is 7. So the answer to our problem is the number of large binders is 20 large binders. and 7 small binders. And we made that one a lot more complicated than we needed because, well, we didn't copy the right equation over. For number 22, we're looking now at a problem that involves dozen packs of tortillas and their cost. So our two variables, we'll make X, it looks like it's going to be corn tortillas, and Y will be flour. So we're going to write our two equations. The first one is the count. How many total did we have? So if I had, I guess I should indicate it's a dozen. How many dozen tortillas do I have of each? Well, X plus Y is equal to 44. And then if I look at the cost, corn costs $2, that's 2X. Flour costs $3, that's 3Y, and that equals the total cost of 109. Now, we're going to take the first equation and isolate it. Let's isolate the X. So it's going to be X equals 44 minus Y. I now substitute that into my second equation, which is going to be 2 times 44 minus y plus 3y equals 109. That comes out to be 88 minus 2y plus 3y equals 109. 2y and negative 2y and 3y leaves me with just y, and then I subtract 88 from 109, and I get 21. Now, if y is 21 and the total is 44, like we originally said, or where we said in our first equation, x plus y is 44, I put in 21 for y, and I get that x is 23. They asked us how many corn tortillas we bought. That was x, so it's 23 dozen corn tortillas. Our last word problem here talks about hot dog buns. We have hot dog buns sold in 8 packs and 24 packs. So we're going to have an 8 pack will be our first one. 8 pack. And Y will be 24 pack. First equation they give us is the total, we'll go with cost first. So an 8 pack costs a dollar, so that's just x. We could put 1x there, but we'll just write x. Plus 2y, because a 24-pack is $2, and that equals our total cost, which is $10. Now, they sold 112 total buns. Now, it's not just x plus y here. Now, remember, that's our money equation, the first one. It's not just x plus y. We actually count for the buns. So in an 8-pack, we have 8 of them, so that's 8x. In a 24-pack, we have 24 of them, so that's 24y. So now we have kind of switched the order we did in the other ones. So in this one, I'm going to isolate again the first equation. I'll number them so I can reference them. And I'm going to write x equals 10 minus 2y and substitute that into my second equation, which gives me 8 times 10 minus 2y plus 24y equals 112. That's 80 minus 16y plus 24y equals 112. So we get 80 plus 8y equals 112. Subtract 80 from 112 and I have 32. 8y equals 32, so y is 4. Our question said how many packages containing 24 buns were sold. That was actually the first one we looked for. That was our y variable. So we would say 4 packs of 24. There's our answer. All right, moving on to our next screen. Now we're looking at solving systems of equations, and we have 3 equations, 3 unknowns. And what I like to look for in this one is notice how, let's number these so we have it. Notice how 2 and 3 have just two variables in them. So if I could eliminate a variable from one of them, I could solve for the other, plug that into either 2 or 3, then I would have two variables, and I could attack the first one, which has x, y, and z. So, using just 2 and 3, that's y minus 2z equals 14, and 4y minus 2z equals 8. I'm going to take, I'll take negative 1 times the second equation, equation number 2. So negative 1 times equation 2 gets me y plus 2z, I should say negative y plus 2z equals negative 14. And I keep equation 3 the same way, 4y minus 2z equals 8. And what I'm doing here is I'm going to eliminate a variable. Could have done substitution with this equation number 2, but I'm going to do elimination here. I get 3y equals negative 6. So divide both sides by 3, and I get y is negative 2. Now, I substitute that back into equation 2, and I get negative 2 minus 2z equals 14. I can add 2 to both sides, negative 2z equals 16. Divide both sides by negative 2, and I get z is negative 8. And now I go back to the first equation and plug in what I know. Well, I don't know x yet, but I know y is negative 2, and z is negative 8. So x minus 2 plus 40 equals negative 5. X plus 38 equals negative 5. I now subtract 38 from each side, and I get x is negative 43. Now we look at number 25, and this one's going to require a little more work because I don't have two variables to isolate in my two equations. So I'm going to have to work through this one. I'm going to pick one equation to eliminate, and I'm going to use a combination of my equations I have to eliminate that one, get it down so I have two equations, two unknowns, solve like I did before, and then work my way back. So if I picked one to eliminate, I say I want to eliminate y. So my goal is to eliminate y. So I'm going to use equation 1 and 2, and I'm going to add those two together. So if I add equation 1 and 2, I get negative 3x plus y minus 7 equals negative 2, and 2x minus y minus 2z equals negative 12. And I combine those, and I get negative x, negative 3z, and negative 11. And I'm going to call that equation 4. So I use those two to get equation 4. Now, same thing, I'm going to eliminate y again, but I'm going to use equation 2 and equation 3. But if I look at it, equation 2, if I doubled that, I could combine it and eliminate y with equation 3. So 2 times equation 2 plus equation 3 is going to give me my new equation, number 5. So we get 4x minus 2y, and remember we're doubling the second equation, minus 4z equals negative 24. And then our third equation was 4x plus 2y plus z equals 1. We get 8x minus 3z equals negative 23. And that's equation 5. So we've kind of done our work now. We've narrowed it down to equation 4 and 5, which I can now use those to eliminate and solve for x and z. So let's use 4 and 5. Well, if I take the opposite of either 4 or 5, that's going to eliminate z for us, because I have a negative 3z for both. So now we're going to do negative 1 times equation 4 plus equation 5, and that's going to help us solve for z, or solve for x, because it's going to eliminate z. So it's going to become x plus 3z equals 11, and 8x minus 3z minus 23. So, it comes out to be 9x equals negative 12. But wait, we have an error. Where did it occur? If we actually look back up at where we eliminated y in the first place, we should have had, instead of a negative 11, it should have been negative 14. We need to bring that down, so it's now a positive 14. And that's going to clean it up, so it should actually be negative 9. Apologize about that. So that gives us x is negative 1. We'll put that up higher. X is negative 1. Now we can substitute that into either of our equations. Let's substitute it into equation 4. So now we're using equation 4, and we get negative times negative 1 minus 3z equals negative 14. 1 minus 3z equals negative 14. Negative 3z equals negative 15. So it looks like z is going to be 5. And now I can pick any of my equations to plug in x and z and find y. Let's go with equation 5. Or not equation 5, equation 3. So that's going to be 4 times negative 1 plus 2y plus 5 equals 1. That's negative 4 plus 2y plus 5 equals 1. 2y plus 1 equals 1. 2y equals 0, so y equals 0. So our final solution we're going to write as a ordered pair for a point. That's negative 1, 0, and 5. All right, let's move on to 26. So it's a multiple choice problems here. Still have to solve them, but at least they'll give us options in the end. So 26 is an absolute value problem. We have to isolate the absolute value. So if I subtract 2 from both sides, I get 2 times the absolute value of x plus 4. John Trotner, please go. Equals 24, or 22, subtracted 2 already. Divide both sides by 2, and I get x plus 4 equals 11. Now, absolute value, I have to set the x plus 4 equal to a positive 11 and negative 11. By doing that, I get x is 7 and x is negative 15. So 7 and negative 15 looks like D. Okay, let's move this over. All right, come down to 27. It said 32 is less than the absolute value of 8 minus 4x. So we're going to copy that inequality over and make the negative. And let's take a look at this one a little bit differently. What if we left it as one statement here? So I'm going to work my way through this one. I'm just doing the same to every side almost of the inequality. So I'm going to subtract 8 from each part. So 32 minus 8 is 24. Minus 4x goes there, and that's negative 40 on the end, because that's negative 32 minus 8. I'm going to divide everything by negative 4. Still an inequality, so when I divide, yes, these become new values, but I flip the inequalities, and I get that x is greater than negative 6, and I get x is less than 10. My answer is D. 28, I need to see the absolute value is equal to negative 7. I have an absolute value is equal to a negative. An absolute value is always positive. It'll never be negative. Automatically, I know my answer is D. Now I look at 29. I like to look at the nicest equation here, or the nicest graph, and use that to help me. So I have this one right here. Now that's y is equal to 1, is the dashed line. So if I look at my options, I have y is greater than 1 because it's shaded above. So any answer that has y is greater than 1, I'm going to keep. Therefore, C and D are gone. Now I've narrowed it down, so I know y has to be greater than 1. I look at my other equation, which is y, essentially y equals negative x plus 3, which is that other dashed line. If I test below it, I could test 0, 0 for it, or I could test any point. Let's test a point we know is inside of it, and that's right there. That's 0, 2. So if I said y is greater than negative x plus 3, which is what it says there, I would say 2 is greater than negative 0 plus 3, which is 2 is greater than 3. That's false. So if I go to B, I get 2 is less than negative 0 plus 3. 3 is greater than 2. That's true. My answer is therefore going to be B. Okay, now we go to our last set here. Looking for the graph of 12 is greater than or equal to the absolute value of 4x minus 8. Let's do what we did a couple of problems ago and just make it one inequality, copy over the inequality, change the sign. I'm going to add 8 to both sides. I get 20, 4x, and negative 4. Divide each side by 4, or each part by 4, I get 5x and negative 1. So this says that x is less than and equal to 5, so it should be in that direction. And x is greater than or equal to negative 1, so it should be in that direction. It looks like C will be our best choice. If the inequality was flipped, we would have chosen D, but they actually go towards each other, so we shade in between. Last one, 31, we need to find the point in the solution set. When we get something like this, we just plug it in and see which one is true. So really pick any one and solve. If I start with A and plug them in, I get 2 times 2 plus 3 times 0, less than or equal to 5. Looks like 4 is less than or equal to 5. That part's true. Now we test the second one. 3 times 2 minus 0 is greater than 6. 6 is not greater than 6, so that's out. If I go with B, that's going to be 2 times 1. 3 times 1 is less than or equal to 5. That's good. 3 times 1 minus 1 is greater than 6. That's false, so that's out. We go to C now, negative 3 and 1, so let's see, that would be 2 times y, or 2 times 1, plus 3 times negative 3 is negative 9, gives me negative 7 is less than or equal to 5, that's true, and then we get 3 times 1 minus negative 3 is greater than 6, that actually is 6, so that's out. So it looks like D is going to be our best choice. Let's check to make sure. 2 times 2 is 4, plus 3 times negative 2 is negative 6, and that is less than 5. And then I would go 3 times y is 6, minus a negative 2 is really plus 2, and that is greater than 6. D would be our answer. That's the only point that fits to both inequalities.